Okay. So now let me welcome you to today's lecture again after the break in last week. No, that's the wrong slides. We should keep to the correct ones. Here we were. So in the last lecture we had a look on structured homogeneous peer-to-peer overlays, and just as a short reminder what structured overlays were. So we had peers, peer identifiers and object identifiers, and the object identifiers are somehow matched to the peers, and we have responsibility areas. And the question is, how do we do the routing? How do we find the peers responsible for specific object IDs? So last time we had a look at Chord, and this time we will, beside having a look at hypercubes and deep Eugene graphs, also a look at other type of overlays in that field. Let me just jump to the corresponding position. Okay, so one of the very typical peer-to-peer overlays that are also very prominent in research, at least, is a content addressable network called abbreviated CAN. It also has been published 2001, like Chord, and this was one of the first ones in the field of structured DHTs, structured peer-to-peer overlays. And what it makes it different from Chord, so in Chord you had one single dimensional ring, and Chord introduces several dimensions. So you can think of a D-dimensional torus. That means that the side are overlapping. So if I'm exceeding the side on the right, then I'm accessing it on the left again. So it's a D-dimensional torus. And in this example, it's a two-dimensional example, but you can also pump it up to 20 dimensions or whatever number you would like to have. In this structure, we have the peers. They have also a D-dimensional point where they are located at. And also the objects have some points where they are located at. So in the example, we have here N2 with a position according to this coordinate, and some objects, for example, files 1, 2, 3, 4, they also have some points. And how do we then define the responsibility areas? For the responsibility areas, there are rectangular shapes, like, for example, N2 is responsible for this quarter of the whole space. And what you can also see, how it is somehow linked, how the files are linked to the nodes, as all of the nodes are responsible for some rectangular areas. We will see how they will be made up. The nodes are somehow placed in these areas, and so also the peers, which are responsible for these areas, are also responsible for the nodes. What's also should be noted that together, the whole space is split up among the nodes, so there are no open fields which is not belonging to any node. So let's see how the topology is created and how it is done. So first of all, we have the points which are belonging to the node. So this is a coordinate, and every node is linked, so has its contacts with its neighbors in the torus. So N4, for example, has the neighbors N5, N3, and N2. And so you can see that the routing table size, so how many contacts you need to know, is of scale D. So it's very strictly linked to the dimension. So because in every dimension you typically have two contacts. And also the network topology is created according to this neighborhood, so in the torus. So N2 has a direct connection to N1 and to his neighboring nodes, and all of the other nodes do it accordingly. So the idea is that we, how do we create then these kind of networks? So how is routing, for example, done? So if a node N5, for example, is looking for a specific file, so N5 is looking for file 3 and he knows the identifier, then he just routes along his neighbors to come closer to the desired object coordinates. So in this case, N5 is rooting to the left, so decreasing the distance according to the x coordinate axis, and the route is quite straightforward, so it approaches with every step towards the desired objects. Of course, also in this case, N5 could have chosen to go first down and then to the left, but this is up to the implementation which coordinate is approached first. According, once the fields which are traversed are somehow calculated, this is the path how the nodes are contacted. So very intuitive how to get closer to a desired point. What should also be noted is the lookup, so the routing table size is O of D, so it's not necessarily 2D that I should correct, and the lookup complexity is O of Dn to the power 1 divided by D. So it's also a square root, not a square root, but a square root D by Dn. And that is basically the shortest distance how to get from one corner to the another one. There you have to integrate the square of the dimension. So just think of it about the shortest, distance routing in that kind of environment. If when you have a that kind of topology. So if a new node wants to join the network, for example, here in this case it's N6, it somehow has to be placed in the existing topology, and it is also valid for how the network is built up. So what you need to do is first you have to pick a point in the topology. For example, let me just see what this this is, for example, the point of N6 which has been chosen, and you have to know one of the peers in the network which you can contact. And what is done next is that the query is then routed to the node responsible for that desired point. So N6 picked somehow its point, it contacted N5, and the join request is then forwarded to N1, because N1 is responsible for the new position of N6. Next, the zone of N1 is split in two halves, and this is one very characteristic point of CAN. It can only split zones in half, so it might be, in this case, splitting according to the horizontal axis. If a new node would arrive in the rear of F1, for example, then it would be a split according to the vertical axis, horizontal axis. And so you always split and divide the responsibility space of every node. So N6 is then placed there. You also might notice that it might get difficult if a node is leaving. So you have if you have a very fractally and recursively split space, for example, here around N6, here would be another split because a new join node would join there, and you would split it up further because new nodes are joining. Then you have a problem if one of the nodes are leaving the network. So, for example, just imagine you have N1, N6, N4, and N5, and N2 is now leaving. Then it's very difficult who should get this area. Should N6 get it to the full, or should but then it would not be according to the splitting rules, so there should be always only sizes of these rectangles as a power of 2. So it's very difficult how to decide which node gets the zones once nodes are leaving, and this is also somehow left out in the paper. Just discussing the advantages. So what is good about it? If you start a lookup, you will definitely find the target because you have a quite a very strict rule how to get there, and you always know your neighborhood, so you know which areas your neighbors are responsible for, and you know your responsibility area very explicitly. It's quite scalable because every node has very limited state it has to maintain, fixed routing table size. And it's sometimes used also as for multidimensional search because it has this multidimensionality already included. The drawbacks are, so the lookup performance is not very good. So to the square of D, that's not very optimal. So optimal lookup performances are around O of log N. And also the relevance in practice is not given because it hasn't been used further on. But why is it presented? Because it's still a very important P2P overlay that is very often cited. Okay, coming to a very much more. Yes, that's the question. Yes, it becomes inefficient. So the question is, what if all n many nodes are in a small scale together very densely? Yes, it becomes inefficient, but it's still assumed that if peers are joining, it's evenly distributed where they join, and so you don't have that kind of hotspots. But if you have larger regions, they join first there before joining a very dense location. And then the routing complexity of this square root is still given. So square root, and that's including n, so the number of nodes. So it becomes inefficient, but also in relation to the number of nodes. Okay, so coming to PestTree, which is very more frequently used, not just in research, but there's also a smaller open source community using an implementation for it. Just to introduce some terms. So the PestTree is a P2P overlay based on a publication by Plexton, and what it uses is a prefix-based routing that you might also know from IP routing. So in a prefix-based routing, you have a long ID, and with every step, you get a closer match of the prefix of the first part of the ID. There's a prototypical implementation of PestTree called FreePestTree, and it's free and used by open source, and it's mostly used in the scientific community. And there are some extensions that you can put on top, for example, PEST. That's somehow an abbreviation for PestTree storage, and it gives a replication layer on top of FreePestTree so that you can at least store some data in it and have it available because it has introduces some replication. So what is prefix routing? So that's very similar to DNS or IP routing. What is done there is you have the public, the PID and object ID, and you don't use binary numbers, but for example, hexadecimal numbers. So from 0 to F, and you have 32 of it, and with every step, one of these, at least one of these numbers are matched to the point where you want to go to. What you also have what we didn't have in CAN or in CORD is a leaf set. That means that you explicitly know your neighboring nodes, not just the closest one to the left and to the right, like in CORD, but also up to 10 closest to the with a higher number and 10 closest with a lower number. And you have also a neighborhood set, which gives you the information about the locally close nodes, so which are, for example, from Paderborn. Yes. Okay, so this is how a routing table looks like. So we have an ID space from 0 to 2 to the power of 128, excluding the last number. And the base, that's basically the letter base, or how many letters you have in the ID which you write down. So in this case, the base is chosen 4. So you have only characters from 0 to 3. Typically it's 16, but for example it's easier to show. Then you have a leaf set with the close. So this is the routing table for this node, so 0, 2, 3, 3, 1, 0, 2, and this is basis 4. You see the leaf set with the greater numbers, which are just a bit higher than this number, and the smaller numbers, which are just a bit smaller than the number. And the routing table is according to this. So in the first line, so it's called first level, you have all entries which do not start with 1. So the first one starts with 0, the second one with 2, so this one with 2, this one with 3. So you have, you know, some peers in your contact list that start with a different character. In the second row of your routing table, you have the nodes starting with 1, but being different in the second character. So in the first one, so 1, 0, that's already you, so you know yourself. And then you know 1 with 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3. In the third row, you have nodes starting with 1, 0, but being different in the third letter. So 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 3. And that's continuing on. So that's how the routing table is made up. And you have the neighborhood set. They might be, so it's not linked to the prefix of what you are looking for. So it's just a random context, but you know that they are very close to you, so you have a very low delay to these nodes. And yes, that's written there. So typically the leaf set is of size L, so that's some magnitude of your base. So in this case it's 4, like the base, or 8. And the neighborhood set, it's also some magnitude of how many you have, so of the identifiers. So it's all somehow linked to the base. Okay, knowing this sets, how is the routing then done? So this is a very simple example for to which nodes the center node has a contact to. And I think that's somehow redundant, but let's jump to the routing protocol. So what you want to do is to use this routing table to come to a point which where we are looking for. So again, the routing table of 1230 and the long number. And we are looking now for the different cases that might occur when we want to forward a message to a given object ID. So let's assume X, so our node, is that specific node with this routing table, and we receive a message with K, with the key K, and we have to decide where we forward it to. So at the end, applying this forwarding rules and routing procedure, the idea is that the message arrives at the desired peer responsible for it. So one very easy task, so case number one, we check whether the key for which the key of the message which we have to route is in the leaf set. So that means, for example, we have a key like this one, so ending with 3, 0, otherwise it's very close to us, so we just have to forward it to the closest node which is responsible for it. So in this case it's the node the next smaller to us. So let me just see, where's my... No? Okay, so this is our number, and this is the message that we receive. And this neighbor, which is listed here, is closer to it numerically, so we forward it to that node. For the case that it's not in the leaf set, so no node in the leaf set is closer, but we are also not responsible for it, so we use our routing table as seen here, And we check the prefix. So how long is the prefix? So let it be small l, which maps to our index, our ID. And this is the key, for example, 103. And we start with 102. So we have a prefix matching of 10. That means two bits, two characters. And so we check at the level 3. That means in the third row. Which node to take, and that's this one. So 10, then 3 is the different character, and this node, so we are connected to it, and we forward the message. For the case that it's not a leaf set, so we don't have a node close to it, and we also don't have an entry, like it's here, then we close the pick the closest node from a routing table which is still closer. So for the example given here, 10233 and so on, this is the column given here, then we use still a node that is very close, and this is let me just see that one. So if we have a missing point here, then at least we can approach very close in the ID space, and hoping that this node has a better fit. What you also can do, if we are, so if the node in which we are currently, so node X, is the closest one, closer than the leaf set and closer than the routing table, then we are responsible for it and the routing can end. Okay. So. Okay, so this is how the routing is used. What you should take out of it is basically that the routing table is used mainly, but you also have the leaf set, which helps you in really knowing your neighborhood, your numerically closest contacts. That's very important, so that you can really make sure that you find the node who is responsible for it and don't miss it. Then the question is, how is the network made up? So how do you set up this kind of routing table? So in this case, I hope you have printed it out probably, but or you have very good eyes. So what you should see here is that the node at the top left, that's node ID 6, is trying to join, and here are some other nodes. So node 1 has the ID H, so node 1, 2, 3, 4, and they have the IDs H, B, C, and V, just for making it shorter. And what we know is that, for example, this node is the locally closest node to Y, so this is the node joining. He might have it from any kind of source, where just knowing that this is the closest that he knows. Then Y sends a join message to his own ID over this node, and this is basically routed along to the node V, which is responsible for it. So this is the node with the node ID 4 is the numerically closest to 6, so he's currently responsible for that ID. What is done then is that all nodes on the path, so while propagating the joining message, answer their own state information to the joining node. So in this case, you see that they all say basically they give information of every of their routing rows of rows in their routing tables to Y by approaching the desired node ID. So for example, as this node is quite far away, for the first hop it only gives the first row. For the second, as the prefix routing approaches, you give the second row, and so on to fill the routing table of the new node. What is also done is that the neighborhood set, that means the geographically or closest by delay, so the neighborhood set is taken from the closest node that you knew, and the leaf set, that means The numerically closest neighbors are taken from the node where you will be placed in the responsibility area. So as node with the node ID 4 is the closest for your node ID, which is 6, you should take his leaf set, which includes the numerically closest contacts of him, because they will be also your numerically closest contacts. And the routing table is filled with entries from all of the corresponding nodes. What is also given then is that once the node joined, he also sends his contact information to the nodes on the way of his joining message. So he announces himself that he's a new node in the network, and they should all check whether he is a better contact in their routing tables, whether he probably fills a hole in the routing tables at that corresponding ID. So many nodes are involved in joining, in enabling the joining of one single node, and there's an exchange of the routing table information. So what is good about it? So how do we approach the churn? So that was the case that nodes were joining, now the case that nodes are failing or leaving. That might, of course, always happen. So what is done for this is periodic checks for the table entries. Keep alive messages are sent, which basically contain "I'm alive, are you also alive?" And if the contact doesn't answer, then he might be assumed to be failed. And exactly that's the point. If the failure occurs in the leaf set, that means your numerically closest nodes, then you have to update the entry. So you have to add one further node. And if you had previously the 10 closest nodes to your ID and one of them fails, then you have to take the furthest node additionally into your node set. If an entry in the routing table fails, that means one of the entries in the rows are missing, then you might ask one of the nodes in the same row to send you one of his entries, because he should know that all of his surroundings. So he should know the nodes in his neighborhood and with numerically close entries. So that specific node on the same row should be able to send you the desired information. Okay, so this was the part to pass tree, and what you should take out of it is, first of all, that they introduced this different kind of routing table, so you don't have just one specific routing table that you can somehow use, but you have also the leaf set, which is very important that you maintain, so that you always know, let's say, the 10 closest or 20 closest IDs to your own ID. And this is relevant to maintain and to keep always up to date, so that you, if a message arrives, you can really decide which node is responsible for it, and you don't leave it to random where it will end up. The same authors of Pastry also published a paper called "Towards a Common RP for Structured P2P Overlays," and not just the Pastry people were included, but also the court people, so Stoika and Trushel is from Pastry, and they try to make up an interface for DHTs that can be reused. And this is also, sadly, one very single attempt to somehow standardize peer-to-peer mechanisms. What you find typically in science is that all of them come up somehow with some own overlay, with some own functionality, and they are very difficultly comparable or reusable. So what they try to do is to provide this API, so-called key-based routing interface, so that you can exchange the implementation of the DHT. So if you program against this API, then you can use either CORD or Pastry or whatever implements this interface. For the notation, just This is a C notation, so the one single arrow is, means so it's read only. That means you can put in some variable, and two arrows means by putting it in this by putting it in a parameter in this variable, and you execute the command. Then at the end, the parameter might be changed, and you can also read it and reuse it. So it's not always just one output that is given. Just to give you an example. So what the API contains is very useful. So the first message, interface is, first command is root. So you define a key where it should be rooted to. That's probably the object ID and the message. And this hint might be null. So just assume that you have a key and a message. Then you can send a message to the peer responsible for that given key. The hint you can use to decide where the first hop should go to. So if you have already a good guess what might be the first contact, you can define the node handle, that means the contact details of that node, and the messages first sent there, and then later the routing table is used. And if you don't define it, then directly your routing table is used. What is then also a second command is that you can that's an upcall message. That means this method is called when a new message arrived and should be forwarded. So by so this command is basically called every time a message passes by, and it informs the application on top of it that here a current there's a current message. You can read the key, you can read the message, you can read what is the next next hop, and you can also change it. So it just informs the application so that you can inspect what kind of messages are passing by, and you can also learn from it. The command deliver is called once you have been found as responsible for the key, then the message is delivered to you. So the API contains roughly about eight commands. So that were the first three. The next one are more for accessing the root state, so to get information about your routing table. What you have first is the lookup command, that you might define the key, you might define a number of how many contacts you want to get as an output, basically. And just ignore for first the save boolean. So what it gives you is a list of possible hops for routing to the key k. And by defining how many hops you want to know, you get an array with the corresponding contact addresses. You can also define the save boolean, which basically only gives you those who have been recently checked whether they are online. So this is useful if you want to know next hops for a given key for whatever application. You might also ask with the neighbor set for a given number of peers in your neighborhood list, so which are very close to you. You might ask for a replica set. This is for tell you what it gives you is a number of possible replication points for a given key. And the max rank gives you the number of how many replications you want to have. So for example, if you define, I would like to have 10 possible replica points for the key K, then it gives you 10 entries where you can store your data additionally on. And this is, for example, used also by the replication solutions, which ask the peer-to-peer overlay where the data could be placed. And the good thing is this is a very strict, so a very deterministic function, so any node might ask for a given key where could the replica points be, and also ask there whether they have the data or not. What is done here with the update function is that you are informed whether when one of the contacts that you know, folks, then is updating somehow. So whether a new node joined, so there you update it so that you can also initiate some further actions. And finally, what is included in the API is that you can ask for the range of one specific node. So if you have the node handle, that's something like the PID, and you ask for the just ignore in at first the rank. So you ask for the node handle, and these are readable parameters. So the function will fill these parameters, and you are able to retrieve the responsibility area of the node handle that you were asking for. And the boolean in the beginning tells you whether it was successful or not. The rank is there to define. So if you define a rank higher than zero, then it assumes or it checks what would happen if that amount of nodes in that specific region go offline. What would be the responsibility area of that specific node then? So just that you can calculate what would happen if peers go offline. Okay, so this is a very useful API in total, and most of the DHTs that are somehow becoming a little bit more successful are trying to adapt to this API, because what is really difficult is to write applications which can operate on DHTs in a way that if you want to exchange the DHT, you don't have to exchange the whole application as well. So if you stick to one API, and this is a prominent one, then you might be lucky in exchanging the overlay that you are using. Some few words to FreePass Tree. So it's very popular, basically, in the scientific community. So if there are some papers on some practical implementations of peer-to-peer networks, they typically, or peer-to-peer applications, they typically put it on top of FreePass Tree. And the reason is, first of all, it's still maintained. That's although it's 2009, that's still somehow very up to date in the terms of other peer-to-peer frameworks. It's in Java, so typically students and the scientists can work with it. And it offers a wide range of applications that you can put on top of it. So there's beside. I will talk shortly about replication, but besides replication, there's also a publish-subscribe mechanism that you can put on top, or you might also have some multicast so that you can do some streaming. So there are some building blocks that you can combine. PEST is very prominent among these because it's responsible for the replication and mainly for the storage. So what it is used for is to ensure that the stored data survives when the node fails. So if you would use normal FreePass Tree without any extensions and you store data in it, then the message is lost once the corresponding node goes offline. What PEST does to circumvent this, to avoid it, is to replicate a new received key r times, so that's a parameter. And so it's not storing the file only once or the data set, but with that parameter that many often. And for that, the application calls the API, the replica set, asking for r replica points where the data could be stored at, and stores also a copy of the key of the data on that node. Okay. Yeah. The good thing is that it's very successful with doing it, and it's also very successful in storing the replicas, very good, well working. And if it wouldn't be so, then the application would have to take care of finding suitable replication locations, and that's very problematic. Okay, so what is some advantages and drawbacks? So what it's good for is that you really have well-documented, clear APIs that you can use. It's modular and extendable, and still has a larger user basis. And what's The point with the modular extendable software is really a good point, because typically if you do some research or if you want to use a peer-to-peer application or to create a peer-to-peer application, then you want to have dedicated functionalities. So for example, in this case, replication, or you want to have multicast, or you want to have specific aspects, and most of them are modularly available, and you only have to implement those which are missing. The functionalities are also very basical, so routing and distributed storage, and it's quite useful. What it doesn't have still is support for heterogeneity. So if you have a network with strong and weak peers, then they are all treated equally. So weak peers that are only for short time online, they are also used for replication and they are not sorted out, for example. And also strong and long-living peers don't get further load that they could handle, so they are also somehow ignored. Security is not included at all. There's a little bit resistance against distributed denial of service for in terms of availability, but if you have malicious nodes, they could change the content that you're storing, and they are difficult ex problems. Currently, there are also some extensions, so there's also project group going on, LiveSocial or peer-to-peer framework, which tries to overcome all these problems with this FreePass tree and to make it as a more usable basis for further peer-to-peer applications. Also, next semester there will be a project group called Peer-to-Peer Framework for social networks, and we are trying then to create that wide toolbox for creating peer-to-peer applications, and one application area will be social networks. We are trying to redo basically Facebook but in a peer-to-peer manner. So there are some security mechanisms will be solved, but in FreePass 3 they are not solved. And the limited API, so it's basically only DHT and only storage, and especially if you, for example, think of more complex applications like social networks or video streaming or whatever, then you need more things, and it's not given by FreePass 3. But still, it's very the most prominent one and used up to date. Coming to some very much more used application, but not in a general sense, but only in a very specific application area, and especially nowadays in file sharing. And I want to present you then Kademlia. This is very prominent. It has been used in Emule and eDonkey, and BitTorrent also uses an implementation of it to create some trackerless mode, and it's quite prominent. But I also want to say, so in comparison to FreePass 3, it's also very limited to that application area. So Kademlia is the main algorithm, so the peer-to-peer overlay that has been presented at scientific conferences, and CUD is the implementation, so the most prominent implementation of the algorithm, which is also used by Emule and other file-sharing networks. BitTorrent, however, uses also an implementation of Kademlia, but it's not compatible to CUD. How does it work? So first of all, you have 160-bit IDs, and what's very important also in comparison to CORD is how do you define the distance between two nodes. In Kademlia, the distance between two nodes is defined by an XOR, that means a bitwise exclusive OR. Here we have an example. We have the number 170 in a bit representation and 149 in a bit representation. And for example, in CORD, you would define the distance as the distance between these two numbers, which is 21. However, in Kademlia, the distance is you create the XOR and you get this number. So 63. So what is the benefit? The benefit is it's symmetric. That means A XOR B equals B XOR A, and it's not the case in CORD. So for example, in CORD, the distance from getting to 149 to 170 is 21, but getting from 170 to 149 in the whole ring is much larger. So it would be of a very large scale. So that means that's not, the distance is not symmetric. And why is it good? Because the connections, like we also saw in CAN, are based on the distance of the nodes. In CAN we had the neighbors of the rectangles as contacts. They had them ambiguously, so both of them were neighbors of each other. In CORD we have only one directional neighborhoods basically, and in this case they are also symmetric. So they are, if A wants B for a contact, then B also wants A for a contact. That's quite useful. What kind of commands does it support? So one of the commands is find nodes. Okay, you can define a specific key, and it gives you the k closest nodes that the network can find. And k is a parameter that you will find many times. So what Kademlia gives you is not one single node responsible for it, but you find the k closest nodes that have been found in the network. You will see what the benefit and also what the drawback is. What you also have, for of course, is that you, if you can find for, look for a node, you can also find for a value. That's basically the same. So you get also the, you would find the k closest nodes, but you don't want to know the nodes. You just want to know the value that is stored on this key. What you can also do, so two simple commands, is to ping an address to check whether he's online, and to store a key, a value under a given key. And with this four commands, the overlay is complete, and they are using themselves to enable the functionality of Kademlia. Let's see how it is done. So first of all, we have to know how is the routing table again created, and this is done by introducing routing tables, so-called k-buckets. A k-bucket is, that we will see shortly, so what every node has is for every bit that, so we have 160 bit IDs, and for all of these bits he keeps a list of contacts. Like we had it with the prefix-based search prefix-based routing tables in PASTRI, it's quite similar. For every bit that is different to your own, you have a row, and in this case in Kademlia you have not one entry per row, but k entries, and that's basically what it's set here. That for every ID, and you have 160 IDs that is different to your own, you have k entries in your routing table. How do you fill them? Basically by learning from messages passing by. So you are somehow integrated into the routing protocol, some messages are passing by, you have to forward them, and from that you learn by the sender's message basically, and the sender's identifier, you learn some new IDs, so you can add them to your routing table. What is also given, because all the time some messages are passing by and you might learn all the time some new node IDs, is that you stick somehow to the old contacts. So if your routing table is filled in that specific region, so you have already k contacts, then you don't drop them away if new messages arrive and new contacts arrive, but you try to keep the nodes which are longer in your routing table also longer inside. So you don't want to exchange the contacts all the time. Okay, so this is especially described in the peer selection policy. So this slide presents if a node termed U receives a message from a node V, and it should be forwarded. Then, first of all, we learn, okay, there's a new node termed V. And we want to check whether we want to put it in our routing table. And the routing tables in Kademlia are called k-buckets. And this is how we check whether we put it in our routing table or not. So first of all, we check whether v is in its corresponding k-bucket. So that means in the bucket which belongs to the corresponding prefix. And if it is so, then we put it at the end. So you will see why we put it in the end. If it's not in the corresponding prefix bucket, in the k-bucket, and there's some space, then we just put it also at the end. So just to give you the logic why we put it at the end, so putting a message contact at the end means that we have seen it recently and we know he's online. And the nodes at the beginning of the bucket, so at the head of the bucket, they're somehow, we don't know. We have seen them a while ago, they have been online that time, but we don't know whether they are online now. So if you put it in the end, then we know, okay, that node is very fresh. Okay. The next case, so if the k bucket for which the contact v is belonging to is full, and the newest one, and the last recently node, so the head of the bucket is alive, then we don't need a new contact, so we check then in this case whether the head of the bucket is, so basically the first entry is alive, and if he is, then we put it at the end because we know it's fresh and we don't need a new contact, so we stay with our old ones. If the k bucket is full and the fresh, so the oldest not checked contact is not alive, then we drop him and insert the new contact. So to just give you a feeling how many contacts you need in a typical Kademlia implementation, is a k of 20 is realistic in a normal application. And that might be quite big. So if you have 160 bits times 20, so you have 3,200 entries that in the worst case you have to, that you in the worst case somehow fill with contacts and you have to check whether they are online. So how is the evolution of the k bucket? So how does the whole process start? This is some example. If we have a node, so this is the whole identifier space, and we, with every step, we separate, so these are the k buckets which are first filled, and if they are overfull, then we split. So, and if the k bucket of according to the prefix 0 is full, then we split further, and if we just, so it's just going down as you see, and this is for the node with the node ID 00, so it's only interested in its own branch. And if that k bucket corresponding to the prefix 000 is full, then it splits and you just continue on your own branch that you will see. So, give you an example. So, we have a node ID 01110, and the k size, so the size of the buckets, so the size of the routing entries per prefix is 2. Then we have, in the beginning, we don't know anybody, then we get a new node. So we learn that there's a new contact. Okay, we put it in our k bucket with no specific with no specific prefix. Then a new node comes. And if a further new node comes, then we check. Yeah, we split it basically because we have key equals 2, so we cannot have 3 entries per k bucket, and we split it. This is how it looks like. A new node comes, so first of all we split. So we have now a k bucket for the prefix 1 and a k bucket for the prefix 0. And this is our routing table that we use. And if a new node comes, then we fill it. Yes. So now both k buckets are full, both for the prefix of 1 and the prefix of 0. And what we do then, so we still participate in routing, and all the time new nodes arrive. Now the new node 11010 arrives, and this one we drop, so we don't want to have it. And why is it? Because we are only interested in the branch of the tree which is corresponding to our ID. So we are only interested in further contact starting with zero. So our knowledge about nodes starting with one is already enough. So no, we don't need more. So we only want to have more knowledge about nodes starting with zero. So a new node comes 01010. So again, we have too many entries in our key bucket. So we split it. Yes, this is the split. So very, you see the correspondence also to past tree where we had this prefix based routing. We also all the time place nodes according to their prefix in corresponding routing table entries. So a new node comes, so it fills our last entry in the K bucket starting with 00. And if a new node comes 00101, then we check whether the corresponding bucket is full. Yes, it's full. And we don't also want to know more about nodes starting with 00. So that means if we would put it here and we have to split, then we would have many more than two entries for nodes starting with 00, but that we are not interested in. So we want to have only two entries. We only want to have two entries starting with 1. We only want to have two entries starting with 00. We only want to have two entries starting with 010. And so we just continue on that path corresponding to our ID. Yeah, this is also depicted here again. So if a new node comes 010, then we just elaborate and extend the branch that we are currently in. I think the principle should be clear. So how is then this routing table used in the whole Kademlia? So what do we do with it? So if you want to find a specific node closest to a target ID, then we send out alpha requests parallel. So alpha requests in parallel. So this is also the difference to CAN and to Pastry and also to CORD. So in the previously mentioned overlays, we only sent one single lookup request looking for the peer responsible for the given ID. And in Kademlia, we send out alpha many in parallel using different starting points for our routing request. And alpha, if it's smaller than k, then we also have different. So if k is the maximum size of our routing table entry, basically for a specific prefix, then we can use up to so many contacts for a first start and for a lookup if you are looking for a desired ID. And what we get as a result is for every of these requests, we get the k closest nodes known by the contact. That means if you are looking for a specific ID, you send out alpha messages, requests to different nodes that are in your routing table, and you receive for every of these requests a list of k next hops, basically, that are closer to the target ID. Out of these alpha times k contacts, you can choose the next hops that you use for your routing. So with every routing step, with every find node request, you get closer to the desired node ID. So what you do? Yeah, you use the results that you received with the messages as the results. And this is also somehow different than we saw in Chord and Kademlia and Can, because in those previously ones we had a recursive routing, so-called. That means that if we sent a message out, then the addressed node forwarded it on. So it didn't answer us the next hops, but it sent it along by itself. And here in Kademlia it's necessary that you don't forward the messages on, but you send only the better hops back, so that the initiator of the query can decide what to do with it. So the routing stops if the K closest nodes don't change anymore. So if you don't get closer to it, then you know, okay, that's it. I cannot get closer, and these are the K closest nodes. Yeah, this is an example again. Routing from 00010 to 11010 with alpha of 2 and k is 2. So we send in the beginning two requests out to two different nodes, and they send us back their knowledge about further closest nodes to the desired target ID. So these are this k closest nodes, these are two per answer, basically, so four nodes in total that we knew, that we learn as new nodes. They are depicted in gray, and then we pick from the closest nodes that they sent us the alpha many, again, closest nodes, so these are these two gray nodes to whom we send our request again. And so you see, with every step we somehow get closer to the desired target ID. And if we don't get closer nodes to the desired ID, then the lookup process stops. Yep. And what you can also see, so what is done there, that's also different to Chord and Pastry, is that we don't store the object only once, so the replication is somehow included, so but we store it on the k closest nodes. We store the entry that we wanted to store, and if somebody else is looking for the same content, then he proceeds with the same routing. And what might occur in Kademlia is that he doesn't get these two closest nodes, but he gets these two closest, because he came from some different direction, and there is no knowledge about, so the nodes don't know necessarily which are their neighbors. That's somehow a drawback of Kademlia, and it might be that a new request matches these two nodes, but there you have still an overlap, and you might find the data that has been stored. So, summarizing, what did Kademlia bring as enhancements? First of all, these parallel queries. So you start alpha concurrent lookups instead of just one. And that generates more traffic load, that's true. But what you also have is lower response times. Because in Chord or Pastry, it might be that you pick randomly somehow very slow node as first hop, and they also pick slow nodes, so it's somehow the slowest way if you have only one. And if you have alpha concurrent lookups, then the time until the first answer arrives is the minimum of the distances out of these three out of this alpha context. So the response times get somehow faster. Network maintenance is better than in Chord, because in Chord you have to actively fix your fingers to check whether they are online, and these are only also unidirectional contacts, so only the one part of a finger is interested in keeping it alive. In Kademlia, however, because having this XOR metric, you just, both parties are interested in knowing each other. And that's a reuse, first of maintenance, and second, you learn by bypassing queries, so you learn from the traffic that's already in the network, and you don't have to start it explicitly. However, one drawback, but it's also benefit on one side, are the large routing tables. So in Chord, you basically have for every prefix, only one finger, and in Kademlia you have k contacts per prefix. That's on one side higher cost, on the other side you have a better robustness if nodes are failing, so you don't need to check it regularly whether they are online, and you don't have to, so the routing is not interrupted if some of the nodes are failing in your routing table. So coming to CAD and saying some words on it, so this is the implementation of the file of Kademlia, and it's used in file sharing applications like eMule and eDonkey and eMule, and it uses UDP as communication, and is also open source. So it has been just developed because Kademlia seemed useful and they wanted to get independent of from servers. And what it can be used for is to find sources for files, and it supports also the keyword-based search. And we will see how it is done. So what is first of all different than Kademlia? So the ID length has changed in order to fit the MD4 hashing. So it's 128 instead of 160. And what is also introduced is, first of all, you have two steps for the file sharing. So first, you find the node that is responsible for a given file, and then you what does it mean it's responsible for a given file? It has the information where the data is stored. So in the second phase, you download the data, the file that you're interested in, based on the information where it is stored from phase one. And it's also not terminating one when only one result is found. So especially for the keyword-based search, we'll see how it's implemented. So that's always showing you some results. What is also used for variables, k is 10, and alpha for the parallel lookups is 3. So if you CAD is available, so you can have a look at it, you can download it and test it. And how is it done? So you first have to know a network in a node in the CAD network so that you can contact it. If you don't know any node, then you can download the hosts file, which lists currently active members in the network. So how is it then used for file sharing? Every file is hashed, and the file content, the file is announced according to its hash. So if you have a file, Britney Spears song, then you hash it, you get an ID, and under this ID you place the information of yourself and announcing, okay, anybody who wants to have the file with this hash can download it for me. Second, each part of the file name, so Britney and Spears and music and whatever, is also hashed, and these are keywords, and under these keywords the file name and the file hash is also listed. So both the file information is stored in the network, but also the keywords. And if you want to, how do you find then the content? So if you know the ID of the file, then you can just ask for contacts that store it, and for that CAD can be used. And if you don't know the source, the ID of the file, then you can perform the keyword-based search. So then you also type in, I'm looking for music and Britney and Spears, and look up the data stored under these keywords. And there, for example, is listed what kind of files are matching these keywords. So we will see an example how these string tokens look like and how this is done. But what the keyword search basically results in is that you get a list of IDs and file names, which you later can pick and say, I want to download it. Then a new lookup is started to see which nodes are offering it. So to have an example, so this is a screenshot of CAD in eMule. And there you can, at the top left, so we were looking for Ubuntu, because that's of course the legal application for file sharing, to download open source files. and open source distributions. And what it lists is, so it uses this name, hashes it, and looks up under the corresponding hash what kind of file names, so also some metadata, and file IDs are listed. And what you can do then is to pick a file and say I want to download. In the background, it starts a lookup to see which nodes are basically listing it and offering it, and there you see from which one you can download it. Okay. Somehow something's missing. Yes. Yeah, exactly. That's what it does. So you first search nodes. Yeah, I mean that's what somehow not what is said. So it's basically redundant. So it's you first look for the keywords and then you download the files. Okay, and this was also the last slide for the homogeneous structured peer-to-peer networks. I will jump now to the next but very shorter part, and so there are only a few slides on this. These are the so-called interconnection overlay networks, and they behave differently than the overlays that we saw until now. And what makes them special, on the one side, you will see which of these are somehow will be presented. These are Hypercube networks and DePuy networks. And what makes them special is that you only have fixed node numbers. So, for example, we will see these are Hypercube networks, these are DePuy networks, and they are only magnitudes of 2. So 2, 4, 8, 16, 64, and so on. But with this assumption and with this drawback, they offer some very performant routing and very stable conditions. So we'll see how they work. So first of all, the interconnection networks. What does it mean? So we assume there's no churn. So no nodes leaving the network and no nodes joining the network. And we somehow can also control the number of nodes. So we don't have a random number of nodes, but only magnitudes of 2, for example. And what we want to have is we want to have overlay network for ID-based routing. So we want to enable to send a message to a node based on its ID. And for that, for this assumptions, efficient network topologies are possible. So why is it presented? Why is it relevant? So if you, for example, have some server cluster or some very controlled environment where you want to still have these distributed systems, then you could have these conditions. So you can make sure that there's no churn, and you can also control the number of nodes. So, for example, if you want to set up your own cluster, and then these kind of overlays are more efficient and more practical to use. So what they offer is, for example, that you have a fixed node degree that is very practical property. So you don't you have a fixed node state that you have to maintain, and the routing is also done very efficiently in O of log n. Still, there are some differences. So to distributed hash tables, so we don't have this key value lookup functionality. As we can't control the number of nodes, we can make sure that the whole ID space is filled with nodes, and so there are no open IDs which are then responsible in the responsibility of some other nodes, but we only have networks which completely fill the ID space. So that means we only have this ID space, ID-based routing, and we don't have any more responsibilities because the network is full. So the Hypercube is a very prominent and simple example for it. So here you see a three-dimensional Hypercube network, and what defines it, so what is the main characteristic of it? In this case, it's a binary d-dimensional topology. So if you have d dimensions and a binary structure, then you have to the power of the interconnected nodes. So that's the fixed number of your nodes, so you cannot vary about it. Of course, you can change the dimension, but you cannot have 2 to the power of d minus 5, for example, or uneven numbers. And the addresses are represented by d-bit binary numbers. So in this case, it's 3 characters of the number. So we have 3 characters because it's 3-dimensional. And every node has a fixed number of neighbors, of adjacent nodes. And this is the number of the dimension. So very complicatedly said what is seen here. So what you basically see is that if you flip, for example, the rightest character, then you go one to the left. If you flip the middle character, then you go to the right. And if you flip the first character, then you go up. So if you think of it in more dimensions, by flipping one bit in the ID, you get to the next node. And this is how the nodes are connected. So very simple, if d equals 0, then you have only one node. If you have d equals 1, then you get to the second node. If you flip the bit, if you have d equals 2, then you basically copy it, the same structure, and you connect. So you for example, add a new character to the left of it. You copy the gray and red construct, and by flipping the bit, you come to the new one. And the same for the three-dimensional. So you take the old structure, add a new ID to the left, new character. If you flip it, then you come to the next level. So if you have four-dimensional node, then you just add a further character. And if you flip it in the beginning, then you come to the second cube. So there's a very simple approach how to create a new how to extend the network and to calculate how it looks like with higher dimensions. So how do you use it then for source to destination routing? So you have a source, you have a destination, and you want to identify how to get there. Of course, we don't assume that you have node joining or failing. And what you do is you simply flip the different bits. There could be some rule which bits to flip first. So first, for example, starting with the left, with the leftest, and with every link you change a bit, you flip it, and until your desired node is reached. Yes, and since you are the network is fully connected, you also have the links and the nodes for the next hop, and you can come to the point where you want to go to. So an example, although it might be somehow clear. So this is the source 0 1 0, and we want to come to 1 0 1. In the beginning, we have three options because the three bits are different, and the number of different bits is the distance to the destination node. That's how many hops we need to come to the desired node. So, for example, we start from the right with flipping bits. So we first flip the rightest bit and come to 0 1 1. Then we flip the next bit from right 0 0 1, and finally the last. Okay, a problem: if nodes would be failing, then you see that there's a problem in finding which next hop to choose and what to do. But this is not considered here. The properties of it, to close the topic of hypercubes, is the diameter is also predictable. So it's very simple to calculate. That's the worst case node distance. And that is by the worst case happens if all of the bits should be flipped, and the number of bits is the dimension of the network. So the diameter of the network is also the dimension of the network. The node degree, this is how many context every node has, and this is also the dimension. So for every bit in the ID, we have a contact with a different bit in that specific point. So as it was said, 000 is connected to the node with the bits flipped in the first, second, and third position. hierarchically recursive network, very simple to extend. Okay, so what are the drawbacks? So first of all, drawbacks, of course, it's only exponentially extendable, so you can only have a exponential magnitudes of 2, for example, as nodes. You might also have not just binary hypercubes, but also trinary. So the basis is changeable, but the number of nodes is still limited. It's also not incrementally expandable. But what it is good for still is that you have this small diameter and small network state. If you increase the network size still, then also the number of contacts needs to be increased. However, it's debatable how tragic this is. It is useful for static environments or in cases when the network is somehow supporting some dynamics. If you attach some further mechanisms how to manage the dynamics. The last topic for today, and it's also as short as the hypercubes, are the de-Purgin networks, which also have the same limitation like the hypercubes, so that you only have exponentials of 2 as possible node counts. And however it does is that you have an r-dimensionally binary de-Purgin graphs, then you have it's from the namings and the numbers a bit strange, but if you have r dimensions, then you have 2 r nodes, you have 2 r plus 1 edges. So we will see what it means. And what you should just have a look at is that every node, also here, has an ID, and it has a fixed number of edges. So it's always 4 in our case. So if if you have only 2 characters, then it's the double of it somehow the numbers I'm not sure. So these 2 R nodes and 2 R plus 1 is somehow not valid. That doesn't seem right. So what you should have is you have magnitudes of 2, so exponents of 2, and every node in this case, and it doesn't matter how long your ID is, if it's binary, then you have only 4 contacts. It is a D graph, and what you should learn, so what is important, how you create the contacts. So what is done is basically, if you want to know to which these nodes has links to, then you just leave out the first letter and add either 0 or 1. So this node 110 has contacts to 101, that's up there, and 100, that's down there. And also, so it's the same principle everywhere. You drop the left number and you either add a 0 or a 1 to the right. And that's why you have only a very fixed size of links to every node, which is 2 outgoing and 2 incoming. So what is the recursive? So how do we construct it? So if we have already a de-Purgin network, then we exchange every edge. For that there will come an example. So what you should know, if there's an edge from one node to another node, basically, so they are from the source node is starting with ui and the last bit is u of log n minus 1. So you drop the first entry, so the first character will be u2, and you add a new one, either 0 or 1. So you just take the edge and replace it by a node. and then you insert the edges between the new nodes according to that rule, and I give you just one example. So if this is a very simple Dibrugine graph with two edges, then you take the edges and replace them basically by nodes and introduce the new edges. So again, so construction, so we have 0, 0, then we this is the first Dibrugine graph. What we do then is we take this edge which was going from 0 to 1, and we give it a node, so we put the node on it, and for every edge we put a node on it. And you can also see from 1 we came with the 0 to 0, so we gets the ID 1, 0. In that node, if we drop the first letter and exchange by 0, then it's 0, 0. Over there we had 0 to 1, so that's 0, 1. And the same here, and it's very simple once understood how to extend the network. So now how is the routing done? So it looks complicated, but it's very simple. So there's a shift match. So first of all, you can check how many of your prefix is matching. I should probably, yeah. So you check how much of the source node's write bits are matching to the left bits of the destination node. And then you can shift. Let me just, I think in the example it's clearer to see what is done. So when you want to route from a specific node to another node, then the only things that you have to do is you drop the first ID, so that should be 0 in the example, and you add a new one to the right, which it will fit later on. And then you drop again the left ID on the current node, and you attach a new one to the right that is better fitting. So if you have a starting node address, then you can only have this left shift by introducing new ID characters from the right. And they also define the next hops in routing. So the left shift operation is essential for routing in Dibrugine networks. So you drop the left letter and the new letter on the right side, and with that, with every hop, you approach the desired ID. The matching operation, which I omitted, was basically to say where to start and which characters to drop first. So if you, for example, want to go from 001 to 101, then you see that with the shift match operation, you can basically calculate that you only have to introduce two new characters. So that is basically the first match of the right side of your source node and the left side of your destination node. And if you know, okay, there they are matching, so I only need to introduce two new characters, and these new two characters are basically the not matching part of the destination, then you know how to proceed to the desired destination node. Again, an example, a longer one, starting from node 1111, going to node 01001. What you do is you see where is the first match, and this is basically the left, the rightest one of the source node, and the rightest one in the destination node. So that one at this position, you don't have to exchange, but no, you have to change all. Sorry. So you just have to know in which direction you introduce the new numbers. So from the node address 1111, the next node that is connected and where you go to is the one with a 0 introduced from the right. Then you introduce a further 1 from the right, and so on until you have the final ID. And so at the end, by introducing and shifting in only all the time new ID, new letters in the ID, you know where the next hop will be to. And also here you have this logarithmic routing, because in the worst case you only have to change every bit, and this is the logarithmus of the maximum number of nodes you can have. So every node has only two outgoing links, because you can only add either 0 or 1, and also two incoming links, because you can only be reached by two nodes. No. Yes, so what are the characteristics? So the average distance is very close to the diameter, so in average and in also in worst case, you also have to insert the whole new ID from the right. What you have is a constant edge degree, so every node has a constant number of neighbors, which is also not changing. Logarithmic diameter and adjacency, so the neighborhood is based on the left shift operation. So where is it good for? Again, controlled environments. Then you can define your network, and you have control over the number of nodes in the network. And when you want to have a very limited node degree that is independent of the number of nodes. Fast routing is also good. What's however still a drawback is that the network size is predefined, so you cannot change about it. So you only have these exponents of 2, and you cannot incrementally expand it, and so it doesn't support that churn. What, however, there are some extensions, and we will see some in further lectures, how still this node network structure can be used to also support churn and have probably. So just to give you an idea, you do not only place one single node at one Deprogene node, but several ones, so that you can still have more or less growing or decreasing network state. Okay, so this was the last slide. So Hypercubes and Deprogene networks we saw, and previously CAN, Kademlia, and PestTree. And the exercise that will be also in 25 minutes down there, so one floor below, that are there you will also see a new exercise number 2, and they are also addressing these overlay networks. So thank you for your attention, and see you soon.